Hi, I'm MG. You're watching Life Unexpected. In the studio today, I have some wonderful guests, Michelle Steele and Angela Beljeski. Hi, ladies. Glad you can make it. Hi. How are you doing today?
Good. Thanks for having me.
Do you always travel in pairs?
A lot of times.
Tell me about it. Tell me why. What is your ministry? What makes you come together today at the studio?
Well, for me, 12 years ago, how this kind of got started with me was I was pregnant with my fifth baby, and I was 5 months pregnant, and I brought my four kids to the clinic to hear the baby's heartbeat and go home, only to find out that there wasn't a heartbeat. And I thought that was the worst day of my life, but actually the next day was I had to have a D&C. And I was awake through the whole procedure, and I remember crying through the whole thing, and I knew too that that was a form that they did to perform abortions, and so I just cried through the whole thing and prayed to God that I offer all this up for the women in my shoes who have been lied to or felt like they don't have a way out. And I felt like I heard God say, I can do that, but I'm going to use you to do it. And I didn't know what he meant at the time, but 3 weeks later, I called the lab to have my baby, it was a little girl, picked up. And when I called the lab to see if I could come get her to have a burial, the lab tech said, well, we're done with your tissue. We'll look on the back shelf and see if we can find it. And I felt like I got stabbed in the heart. And but I'm grateful she said it, because I got a taste of what the world's view is on the development of a baby. And so from that experience, I decided to get involved in pro-life. So at the age of 28, I started volunteering at a crisis pregnancy center. And they had a little six-week training session. And I was raised Catholic my whole life. I knew abortion was wrong, but I couldn't believe how little I knew about abortion, about chastity. And so from that experience and volunteer counseling with these girls, I decided to get out and start speaking to these teens.
I see. Okay. So, what was the name of that crisis pregnancy center?
Abba Crisis Pregnancy Center in Elk River.
Okay. Okay, wonderful. And is that how the two of you met up then? Or?
Well, then I'd been doing that for 3 years and speaking on my own, and then I met with some women from Rachel's Vineyard. I just wanted to meet with women that were post-abortive to hear my talk, to give any advice, and they loved it. They said, we wish we would have heard something like this when we were younger, because we were never given all the facts before our abortion. And they said, we think we know someone who would be interested in speaking with you. And so they introduced me to Angela.
Okay.
And by that time, I was out speaking myself of my own personal life, of having gone through an abortion myself, and the pain and the suffering that I went through for many years. And I had found healing in many wonderful places with the help of Christ. And so I was already speaking myself to teens. I felt very drawn to speak. When I went back into the church, I hadn't been in the church since I was little, and I had went to confession after like 20 some years, almost 30 years. And the priest in there was so kind, and he said, no pit so deep that Jesus' forgiveness cannot reach you. And
do you know that's a quote from Corrie Ten Boom?
He said it was from, he was talking about some book.
It's called The Hiding Place.
Okay.
Yes. That touched your heart.
Yeah.
What he said.
It just, it was a beautiful thing for him to say. And he had actually given me a brochure to go through an archdiocese program for healing. But when I walked out of the confessional, I felt so much joy. I mean, more joy than I can even explain. And I went to Mass, but when I walked out of that confessional, in my heart, it was like Jesus was saying, you will speak. And I had no idea at that time what that meant. But after going through different healing, I started to speak. And then some friends of mine through Rachel's Vineyard had met Michelle and had mentioned she was looking for someone to speak with her. So then I went out and heard her give a chastity talk. And we just, since then, we've
just
done
really
many
hit it off too, probably on a personal level.
Yeah.
Seems like you guys are really good buddies. So I know, Michelle, you represent pro-life across America, and I have this pamphlet that that you brought to, not pamphlet, excuse me, a little mock of a billboard. Can you had it said you had a story behind yep. that. Would
that's
you mind
actually,
sharing?
Sure. That's my son Ben actually, and they decided to use his picture when he was 4 years old. Mm-hmm. And so I was explaining to him that he'd be up on a billboard, and he asked what a billboard was, so I explained it to him, and then he said, "I don't want to be up there, I'll be scared."
Oh. So
he thought literally he was going to be
on the billboard. Now, this is him though?
That's him.
Mm-hmm. He wasn't four at the time when this was taken.
No.
Okay, because how old was he in this picture?
Yep.
3 months, beautiful mm-hmm. little baby. Embryos are babies' heartbeat in 18 days. That's from Pro-Life Across America, where Michelle represents. And she has her friend Angela with her too. And you when you speak with Pro-Life Across America, do you tie in the Rachel's Vineyard mm-hmm. aspect of it? So that's mm-hmm. post-abortive healing.
Right. They're all over the country now, and actually the world. Mm-hmm. I have a friend that just took and went to Russia, and they've now held several mm-hmm. Rachel's Vineyards in Russia. There are so many, you know, so many. I mean, you think of the millions of children that, you know, have been aborted. Each one of those has a mother and a father, mm-hmm. and there is a lot of suffering people out there. And I was one of them at one time. I mean, I still have but God has healed so much in my life, mm-hmm. and but still in my heart, I feel their suffering, and I know what I went through for 17 years before I found healing. Mm-hmm. And there's so many people out there that haven't found it yet. And Rachel's Vineyard, it is one venue out there that they can seek to find healing. And it is a beautiful, and it encompasses all faith or no faith. Mm-hmm. I mean, you don't have to have, you don't have to believe. You just come for healing and hope. Mm-hmm. Just have hope in your heart, and you can come and find healing.
Mm-hmm.
The Rachel's Vineyard I'm connected with here in the cities, we are Catholic based, but we're open to every denomination.
Now, you said that you felt a sense of wanting to be healed. What made you go in that realm? Is it something you thought about? Is it how you were responding to the world around you? What made you seek help?
I think for me, I spent so many years thinking that the abortion had been the answer to that problem, because mm-hmm. that's what society had. And I didn't have a lot of faith given to me when I was younger, so I kind of globbed onto the world and everything. But I still had enough in me, enough of the Holy Spirit in me that was touching my heart. And I as I got older, mm-hmm. I started to reflect, because I never wanted to have children or anything after the abortion, even though I had before, when I was younger, before the abortion. And as I got older, I started to reflect, and I don't know exactly what it was. It may have been signs like that, or just hearing people say, you know, just hearing about and seeing babies and my friends having children. And I think it was a combination of things. Mm-hmm. And then I just started asking Jesus, you know, I started thinking about heaven and Jesus, and I thought, you know, I'd like to go to heaven someday. So I would pray to Jesus for a couple of years, if the abortion was wrong, open my eyes and show me. Mm-hmm. And eventually I actually started going to church every Sunday, which was something I had never been able to really do. Mm-hmm. And suddenly the scriptures just spoke in my heart. I mean, they never did before. You know, I'd look at the Bible and suddenly I was here, because I was asking Jesus, was the abortion wrong? And suddenly I was hearing, I knew you before you were born. I knit you in your mother's womb. I mean, these verses were coming out at me, and then I went to confession, and God just opened my eyes from that time on and just took hold of my heart and just walked me through, and I had never been confirmed, so then I was able to be confirmed. Mm-hmm. And I've just given him my will. And it started just by saying every day, God, let your will be mine, let my will be yours. And the next thing I knew, I was doing things that I never would have thought I would have done. Mm-hmm. And Christ just brought so much into my life, mm-hmm. and so many blessings in it, that I just see so many people walking around there wounded, mm-hmm. and know from my own life how many are wounded out there, mm-hmm. and how much peace they could find.
Mm-hmm.
You know, and my heart hurts for them. It mm-hmm. just hurts for them every day.
I really appreciate you sharing your story. It's just absolutely wonderful that you have the courage to do so, especially through a situation like this where you know it'll be seen by many viewers. Yeah. I really appreciate it. I've often heard that a mother can never be an ex-mother. You can have an ex-boyfriend, an ex-neighbor, an ex-client, but you can never become an ex-mother.
Exactly.
So, when we get back from the break, if it's all right with you and you feel comfortable to talk a little bit about your abortion experience, sure. Going into the clinic, how were you approached, certainly. How you were kind of siphoned through the whole process, mm-hmm. because as we know, St. Paul is building a 7-story Planned Parenthood. It's going to be the third largest in the country, and it'll be right downtown. So we want to keep in mind for the viewers how that process will happen for them, mm-hmm. unless they stop and give it some thought what's happening. And then, Michelle, how about you as far as your talks with the teenagers and working with pro-life across America? Do you find anything that makes a person blinded or not open to your speaking about the unborn or your talks on chastity? What makes them draw a blank? They're not interested, not willing to have open mind about it. Do you have any thoughts on that?
Actually, we have been so blessed that they are open. Mm-hmm. And when we speak, every time you can hear a pin drop. Mm-hmm. And the teachers always comment, we've never had a whole group, it's usually about 100, that are listening this intently. Mm-hmm. But I think abortion in itself is an interesting topic, mm-hmm. and because it's the truth, they are very open-minded. Mm-hmm. We hear a lot of people make the comment, how can you speak to teens, they're so tough, but actually I think teenagers are far more open-minded than an adult, mm-hmm. so we actually haven't come across teens that are hostile or upset with us, or they're mm-hmm. very open. Mm-hmm. And I think after hearing her story, mm-hmm. it's pretty hard to argue that.
Right.
Yeah, they're moved.
Wow. Mm-hmm. Well, I'd say it's pretty hard to argue not to stay tuned for our second half of the show with our two guests here with Life Unexpected. We'll be right back. Thank you.
St. Michael Broadcasting is a nonprofit, volunteer-operated station devoted to providing quality Catholic television programming for the Twin Cities. We operate entirely on contributions from our viewers. If you would like to help support us in our mission, consider making a donation. You can send your tax-deductible donation to St. Michael Broadcasting, P.O. Box 131202, St. Paul, Minnesota, 55113.
For a free program guide, call us at 612-724-2265.
Visit us online at www.stmichaelbroadcasting.com.
We're back. Thank you for joining me again for the second half of our show. In studio, I have Michelle Steele and Angela Beljeski. We're talking about a wonderful process of healing and help for people who aren't aware of it. Angela, before the break, you were talking about your own personal experience, mm-hmm. choosing a violent solution to an unplanned pregnancy. Yeah. Are you okay with walking us through the process, how you went to a clinic and everything involved? Because I think it'd be very helpful for our viewers.
Certainly, yeah. Well, everybody's situation is different. When I've heard a lot of stories, but we all share a lot of similarities. And for me, I had dated when I was a teenager, but I had never engaged in sex. And then I had met a guy when I was 19, and he told me everything I wanted to hear. And I just, you know, I wanted to hear that, you know, everything he, it just, and there were people around me that were not happy with how he was. Mm-hmm. But, you know, love is blind, as so they speak, but true love is not blind, but the love that I had claimed back then was blind. Mm-hmm. And so we dated, and we did start to engage in having sex. And it was a very bad situation, because after that, there's a bond that forms when you have sex, and that's why it's beautiful in marriage. But outside of marriage, that bond happens, and he became extremely emotionally abusive. And as time went on, it just got worse and worse, and eventually I got pregnant. Mm-hmm. And I was, I didn't really think about the pregnancy as a child. It was, you know, I'm 47 and I was 20 at the time, so it was a long time ago. And we didn't have the beautiful ultrasound pictures that we have now that show the development of a child. So I heard society. That's what I heard, and that mm-hmm. was what was around me. And society said they had a solution to my problem. It was legal. You know, at that time, you know, women's liberation was a big thing coming around, and, you know, I am women, hear me roar, it's my body, I can mm-hmm. do what I choose, all of this. And then I had a fear in there of a man who was emotionally abusive. Mm-hmm. So I did address the pregnancy with him, and he, I said I wanted to have an abortion, and he was like, fine. And he never mentioned getting married or anything. So,
did you confide in anybody outside of yourselves?
No, I didn't. Mm-hmm. I was living at my with my parents at the time, and my folks had met the father for a very short time, and they didn't like him, and so I just didn't think I could go to them, and it didn't. There was nobody. I really.
No. Do you think if you had told someone other than yourself and your boyfriend, would that have made a difference?
I think that if I would have had someone out there, or I like to think, mm-hmm. that if I had had someone in my life that I could have shared. Mm-hmm. Sorry. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. I, you know, would have not chose the path. If I would have had a little more understanding, mm-hmm. you know, of things. But I didn't. And so because society was out there and it was full force, you mm-hmm. know, telling me this was a solution, mm-hmm. No one would ever have to know. Mm-hmm. I mean, that was a big one, you know. And so I sought it out. And
did you go to a clinic or?
Yeah, I my boyfriend and I both went to clinic. I can't remember the actual name of it. And this is not unusual for people who have had abortions. A lot of times when people have abortions, they cannot remember a lot of parts of what takes place that day. But I do remember going to the clinic with him, and there was a lot of women in the waiting room. Mm-hmm. And I remember them calling my name, and I went up there, and I paid them $200. Mm-hmm. My boyfriend didn't have any money. And
how were they towards you in the clinic? Did they offer you any suggestions of positive experiences for not only your future, but the future of your unborn child? Did they talk to you about anything like that?
No, and they did have what I always kind of laugh as what they call the counselor. Mm-hmm. And you went in a room and you spoke to this counselor, but it wasn't really like they were asking you how you were with it. It was more, were you on birth control pills, you know? Mm-hmm. It was things like that for their statistics, for mm-hmm. their things. It wasn't really asking you, you know, mm. what kind of place you were in, have you thought of,
right.
you know, keeping the child, where anything like
or
that.
Basically addressing your fears. They never
right.
addressed
exactly.
your fears.
Mm-hmm. Nor was it really explained what the procedure was. Mm-hmm. So I really didn't know what was to happen. Mm-hmm. So they took me into a room, and I was left sitting on a table mm-hmm. and for what seemed like a long time. I'm mm-hmm. not sure how long it really was. Mm-hmm. And during this time, I heard what I thought was a child crying mm-hmm. in the next room. Mm-hmm. And I remember thinking, why would a child be here? And then the doctor came in, and a lady, I'm not sure if she was a nurse or not, but she was there to hold my hand. Mm-hmm. And they began the procedure, which they gave me a mild sedative. And the procedure itself was excruciatingly painful. Mm-hmm. And it was something that will never leave me. And you couldn't do anything, because once they started, there was no stopping. And I cried and cried and cried. And it was horrifying. It was like being tortured. And then at some point during it, I remember thinking, the child I thought I heard crying in the next room wasn't the child. It was the woman before me having her abortion, weeping. Mm-hmm. And when they were finished, they took me out of the room, mm-hmm. and there was a hallway, and it was all filled with recliners. Mm-hmm. And there were all these women that had had their abortion. And you just had to sit there until they told you you could go. Mm-hmm. And it was a very empty place. Mm-hmm. It was a very...
Well, I just know the place you're in now is one of healing and strength, yes. or you would not be on this show.
Yes.
So I praise God for that. Yes. I praise God for that. And by you opening your heart to your story again, I'm sure it's got to be so painful every mm-hmm. time. You've just allowed other people to heal and find hope in that situation. And Michelle, you know, having a friend like Angela, mm-hmm. you must feel awful special
to have
a woman with such compassion mm-hmm. and love for others. Because
I do, and because we're such good friends, the pain she goes through before, mm-hmm. during, and after she speaks is a lot. So I appreciate that she does this for the church, for all the women that are and mm-hmm. men that are mm-hmm. suffering with this, or to prevent it from happening. She gets hugs after from teenage guys, girls. They'll sob and sob and hug her and be so grateful that she did it. And so it's hard to hear her and not be moved. Mm-hmm. Everyone is touched.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. I would definitely agree to that. Now tell me your aspect. When you talk to the teens, mm-hmm. do you start out the talk? Mm-hmm. How do you start out the talk?
Yeah, I have about 20 minutes, and mm-hmm. I give like the statistics, the facts of abortion, the risks of having an abortion, the development of the baby, mm-hmm. what it means to be pro-life, things they can do if someone's considering an abortion, what crisis pregnancies centers have to offer. And so I do that for about 20 minutes, and then when I'm finished, she gives her 20-minute testimony, which kind of backs up everything I mm-hmm. just said. Mm-hmm. So.
And are you both willing to go anywhere that the Lord sends you to, mm-hmm. Different churches or anywhere,
yeah.
really,
yeah.
churches,
yeah.
social events, any place mm-hmm. where God sends you. Mm-hmm. The dynamic duel, huh?
Yeah.
Now, when you said you talk about the fetal development of the little tiny unborn baby, do you bring something out like this?
I do, and I pass mm-hmm. it around.
Mm-hmm.
The one I pass around is similar to that size, the size and development of a 12-week baby, which is when most babies are aborted.
Mm-hmm.
And we pass that around so they can each touch it and
mm-hmm.
feel it.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. 'Cause this unborn baby right here is 10 weeks old.
Okay.
So basically, you're telling me by the statistics, most children are aborted at
12 weeks.
Mm-hmm. So we're looking mm-hmm. at
right.
a child like this.
And all of that's there, the hands, the feet, the eyes.
Mm-hmm. 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 And let me ask you this. You also said that there's a lot of resources for a woman if she wants to build a positive future, not only for herself, but her mm-hmm. unborn child.
Mm-hmm.
Tell me about that. How can they get in contact with those resources?
Well, I encourage them to call a crisis pregnancy center. And if they do, I tell them specifically, ask, is it, are you 100% pro-life?
Mm.
Because some of the name of their organizations can be misleading, look pro-life, but it's not. They'll refer them to an abortion facility. So I just encourage them that when they do call, to make sure it is pro-life.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. How can some places be misleading? What do you mean by that?
I think that the name, they don't say we're an abortion clinic. So that's, I just warn them just to be careful of that. And even if they don't perform abortions at that place, they might tell them to offer them a name of a place that would offer those services.
I see.
Where a crisis pregnancy center would never do that.
Yeah, I found in my experience just talking to different guests and my own personal experience being a crisis pregnancy counselor for 19 years, our hearts are full of compassion. It's not about controlling the woman.
Right.
It's not about telling her what to do. It's about building a positive future, not only for herself, but her unborn child. And how can someone get a hold of the Dynamic Duel if they wanted to?
Well, they could call Pro-Life Across America.
Pro-Life Across America, and ask for Michelle Steele and Angela Beljeski. And that is just absolutely wonderful. Keep up the great work that you're doing. And I so appreciate you both from coming. I usually give my guests high fives, but we'll try it a little bit far. Did you have something, Angela? It seems like you wanted to say a last word or two.
Just for anyone out there that's suffering with from an abortion, you know, just open yourself up to Christ and the Holy Spirit. And know that there are people out there that are praying for you. And that there is hope, because you don't have to live in the place you might be at right now. And that when you step forward, the secret isn't, most places are very confidential. So you can step forward and find healing in confidentiality, but then you also step forward and share with others and meet others. So your secret isn't no longer a secret and it becomes healing.
Wonderful. Absolutely wonderful. Project Rachel is one of your resources that you've mentioned on the show. Rachel's Vineyard.
Rachel's Vineyard,
Excuse me, I beg your
pardon. That's okay.
Lots of great information coming out to you today. I really appreciate you joining the show, and I hope this information helps you change your mind for life.
Welcome to Channel 16. I am Father Kenneth Baker. I'm the founder of the company that started the Channel 16 20 years ago. It's now called St. Michael's Broadcasting. We're delighted to be able to bring Catholic broadcasting to you through EWTN and other Catholic programs. And we ask you, in your kindness, to support this Catholic apostolate of television.